Thanks a lot, Thomas. It's my great pleasure to be here as well. Feel being among friends, actually. After we had George last year from our group joining here as an intern, we made a lot of friends, actually, in Microsoft here in Cambridge. So, yeah, my name is Nikos, as Thomas mentioned to you. And indeed, I'm coming from the most beautiful city of Thessaloniki, though I'm not from Thessaloniki. So I have here to explain a few things about Thessaloniki. I assume you all know that from Thomas already. Just a few things where we are. The northern part of Greece has been named after the half-sister of Alexander the Great, which was a mermaid according to the myth, and continued asking whether Alexander was still alive or not, as the myth says. So the name of our university comes from the philosopher Aristotle, and this is our university in the city campus, and this is the area where our laboratory is. It's a bit outside of Thessaloniki, some new buildings of the university. And this is our group. We are called Wireless and Photonic Systems and Networks. We are about 25 people now, and this is a top view of the area where we're currently also trying to build a 5G front hall testbed. And these are some pictures here of our laboratory. This guy, probably you remember him from last year, who was here as an intern. So some history. Our history is actually tightly bound also with funding from European projects. Otherwise, it would not have been possible to build this laboratory and do this type of work. So it started all in 2010, with the first project being Platon on plasmonics for optical interconnects. It was the first project proposing to use plasmonics for optical interconnect applications. And the RAMPLAS project, which was about integrated optical RAM memories. And after that, we were lucky enough to continue with a number of projects in the area of optical interconnects. And 2014, we had the first European summer school of optical interconnects held in Thessaloniki. So it was a good mixture of people coming there and giving very nice talks. Some other projects that we got, streams, plasma from L3 matrix 3 years ago. And now we have Placimos, Chameleon, and Moicana, actually. And last summer, we had the third European summer school again held in Thessaloniki about optical interconnects. We had also Nikos there as well. From University of Cambridge. So this covers the area of photonics and computing. We are also active in the field of 5G. Here we had a couple of projects as well. Now we are running a big 5G PPP project called 5GFOS in that area. So the blue shaded projects have been projects that we have been coordinating. So we have some experience also as well in how to coordinate big European projects. So the total amount of funding raised during the last 10 years has been around 8.4 million euros. And here are some pictures how it all started. So from the first time in the lab without having anything and how we ended now up with a fully equipped laboratory, actually. So yeah, three of our PhD students have been awarded the IEEE Leo Photonic Society Graduate Student Fellowship. So it was Dimitris, Christos, and Pavlos for 3 years, from 2014-2017. And what we're working on, we're covering a broad range of activities. We're actually starting from device and circuit design and technologies. We skip the fabrication steps, so we rely on partners for having our chips fabricated. We get the chips packs and incorporate them in system experiments, so we're doing the system experimentation, and we also continue up to protocol and algorithmic level for designing network architectures. So we cover integrated photonics, plasmonics, optical RAM memories, optical switching, optical interconnects, and 5G networks. So a range starting from nanometers and going up to kilometers. The neuromorphic stuff is missing from that because it's neuromorphic. Our activity on neuromorphic is relatively new, so didn't have time to update this one. So let me start now with the main subject of my talk by making a flashback to 2010 and to the projections that were made by that time on how high-performance computers should evolve till 2020. So here you can see what was the trend, for example, here of the number one high-performance computing machine till November 2010, which shows actually that performance has increased 10 times every 3.5 or 4 years and was at close to 1 petaflop. So the projections were that it will follow the same trend, and by 2020, it will be at one exaflop. But if we bring down all the number one high-performance machines, then we can see that the slope has changed. So it does not increase as was expected. So now we are here, actually, and the gap from the initial slope continues to increase. This is the main problem of the high-performance computing area, the energy. And this can be realized by looking at today's world's number one high-performance computer, which is the IBM Summit, which has a peak performance of 200 petaflops, which is around 20% of the exaflop target, but already consumes 10 megawatt, so 50% of the 20 megawatt limit that was set for the HPC machines by 2020. And in the area of data centers that were consuming around 3% a couple of years ago, projections say that the total percentage of global power that will be consumed by 2025 will be around 20%. So it's very critical to bring down energy consumption in order to be able to retain progress. Another important problem is the energy efficiency problem and the utilization problem. Here you can see a graph showing on the y-axis how intensive on CPU and memory resources and application is, and here how intensive on input-output communication. So we can see a large number of workloads with a high diversity among the resource requirements. And high-performance computing lies on the top right, so it's the most intensive in terms of CPU, memory, and I/O simultaneously. So due to this high diversity of workloads, up to 50% of the resources are underutilized, which of course impacts the cost and energy of data centers. And the way out has been sought in the following solutions. Regarding energy, the way out has been sought in replacing technology by bringing more and more photonics into the hardware of HPCs and data centers. So this is the vision that was set a few years ago, with optics going up to the board edge and then into the board up to reaching on-chip level and having communication at all hierarchical levels via light. And regarding resource utilization, here a new trend in architecture called disaggregation has been launched. I suppose you're all familiar with that. Disaggregation means actually that it's the server boards do not include any more rigid percentage of CPUs, memories, and I/O modules, but instead you separate the computing machine into pools and you concentrate all computing resources at some pool, all memory resources at some other pool, storage resources, another pool, and I/O here, so that everyone can use whatever he needs to. This changes, however, the networking requirements. So here someone can see, starting from a CPU to CPU communication and going up to CPU to hard disk communication, how the memory bandwidth and the latency scale in a typical server box. So the bandwidth when going at the CPU edge has to reach around 500 gigabits per second, while the latency has to be 10 nanoseconds. And latency can relax as we move closer to the hard disk. This all means that for a disaggregated environment, in order to be able to retain a similar performance as with a typical server box architecture, the switch requirements that have to be used have to guarantee sub-microsecond latency values, bandwidths that can be higher than 10 gigabits per second per port, and a switch radix that can be hundreds of ports in order to allow communication between individual memory, CPU, and I/O resources. And if we pay a look at how the electronic switches, electronic routers actually behave, here we can see, for example, a typical Arista switch, 64 port with 10 gigabits per second every port. So here someone can see that it has a 380 nanosecond latency, which is okay, and consumes 175 picojoule per bit. But if we want to increase the number of ports, so scaling from 64 to 256, retaining the same line rate, here we get a significant increase in latency. And this is mainly because in order to scale the number of ports, actually you use more line cards. which increases the latency, goes up to 2 microseconds. And if you here increase the capacity by increasing just the line rate from 10 to 40 G, you can see that the latency, of course, remains high, but now also the energy efficiency goes up to 300 picojoule per bit. So these are solutions that cannot scale to cope with the requirements of disaggregated architectures. So to summarize some challenges across all hierarchical levels, starting here from the rack level, as I already explained, the latency in high port switches that is currently more than 2 microseconds, and the energy that increases with the capacity as we scale the line rate of the switch ports. If we go to board level, here we have the interconnection of chips between each other, mainly relying on point-to-point QPI-based protocol, which allows, however, only for up to 8 nodes, 8 sockets to be connected together. If we scale this number of nodes by using an intermediate switch, then obviously latency increases again and makes the system not viable for the type of application that we want. And even on chip scale, the settings at chip level are non-modular, and almost 40 or 50% are consumed by on-die caches, and the energy here is dominated by memory access. Today I'm not going to concentrate so much on that level regarding the solutions that we had proposed, but I will mainly focus on these two levels in the field of optical interconnects. So this is our work, actually, and what I'm going to present here mainly today. We have an optical packet switch that we have demonstrated, an experimental prototype called Hipoλαος, which has been shown to allow for 1,024 port connectivity with 10 giga line rates, so allowing for 10 terabits per second capacity, which can scale to 40 terabits per second. This is an experiment that we're currently doing during this period, and can retain latency below 1 microsecond, significantly below 1 microsecond. At board level, this is the work that we have been doing in a nice European project called ICT Streams, where we have an onboard disaggregated architecture that allows for more than 8 sockets to be directly connected, so single hop communication, with having low energy consumption and low latency by utilizing silicon photonics technology and electro-optic polymer board technology. At chip level, we have proposed here the architecture of disintegrating even at chip level by using some ultra-fast optical memory architecture. So we have demonstrated experimentally here optical static RAM technology up to 10 gigabits per second, and we have validated via simulations that the disintegrated chip scale architecture can allow for significant speed up. Question? Yes, please.
Just for the optical packet switch, what kind of packet sizes are you targeting?
Here we have, I have the results later on. So we have used very small packets of around 400 bits, just custom packets, to validate the principle there. So it can function with whatever size of packets after, let's say, length of 10 nanoseconds.
And still achieve the full line rate?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
And are you going to tell us more about the optical RAM technology?
Unfortunately not. But we can discuss later on if you want to. I do have some slides in my laptop. I couldn't fit everything in, otherwise I would stay here until tomorrow probably. So our vision has been then to disaggregate at rack level, reaching down to disintegrating at chip level. This has been actually the first concept proposed by Oracle a few years ago with the concept of the microchips. So now let me start by explaining a few things about the Hipoλαος optical packages. So Hipoλαος comes from a high port, low latency, wavelength routed, all optical packet switch. In other words, someone can name the Hipoλαος as being the architecture that can use AMOL technology for architecting a novel and practical disaggregation switch. And why is it old? Because it relies on well-known broadcast and select switch designs. It exploits cyclic AWGR-based wavelength routing, where, as you can see here, it has several input ports, and you can launch a number of wavelengths at a single input, and every different wavelength gets directed to a different output. So depending on the wavelength that you have here, you decide what will be the output port of the AWGR. And the last well-known old thing is the optical delay line-based feed-forward buffering. So this is a technology that was investigated early 2000s a lot, relies on simple fiber delay lines in order to allow variable buffering of the packet. So we have consolidated these old technologies into a novel architecture, with the main target being to optimize latency. So here, now we've broken down the latency contribution from several parameters. So first of all is the switch configuration, reconfiguration time, the contention resolution, and the header processing. So for switch reconfiguration, the optimum solution is to rely on distributed control architectures. So we have adopted here a spanky layout. Here you can see the architecture where the input gets split into 16 branches. One of them will get activated depending on which output port you want to use. And at the output, you consolidate all the signals coming from all the inputs at the certain outgoing port that you want to employ. For contention resolution, in order to retain low latency, you have to avoid optoelectronic conversion, SerDes and electronics buffering, and you have also to avoid the typical retransmission schemes, so packet drop and retransmit schemes. So here we want to retain line rate, so we decided to use optical delay line buffering, as you can see here, so several fiber delay lines allowing for variable packet buffering values. And for header processing, here we can use a technique for avoiding SerDes that parallelizes the header in the optical domain by means of subcarriers of different wavelengths so that you can directly recognize every bit. This has been a technique proposed by Nicola Calabretta a few years ago. So the way it works, once the packets arrive at the input, it gets split, half a part of the packet goes to the FPGA controller where it gets its header processed in order to decide how to route the packet. And the other part of the packet goes here, where it gets broadcasted to all 16 branches. And let's assume that both packets have to live through output one. So only these tunable wavelength converters here get activated, all other get blocked. So packets have to enter the output one. So in order to avoid collision, here you use the fiber delay lines, which means that in order to select a different fiber for the two packets, we activate here a different wavelength at the wavelength conversion stage. So this packet gets red, this packet gets blue, which denotes that the blue packet will be directly transmitted without being delayed. The red packet will go into this fiber, so it will be delayed by one packet slot. So at the end, they will arrive one after the other at the output tunable wavelength converter, where so they have reached the single output of that plane that was the initial target. However, both broadcast and select architecture and optical delay line buffers are not practical for high port scaling. So the question is here, how to scale this into the 1,000 port configuration that I mentioned to you below. We have done this by using several parallel planes. So this plane has been parallelized 16 times here, and we have interconnected them all together by using horizontal AWGR cyclic switches. So an AWGR here has one of every input connected to the number one output of every different plane. So in that way, the packets that had arrived here can live through this floor, actually, at every output port, depending on the wavelength that they will be imprinted on at this tunable wavelength converter at the output. And at the same time, packets coming from other planes at the same floor, they can reach the same output port because due to the inherent properties of the AWGR, they can reach the same output when being printed on a different, they have to be printed on a different wavelength to reach the same output. So here at the output, you can get packets from all over, from all the planes being carried on different wavelengths. So by using a 16 input vertical plane and the 16 by 16 AWGR switch, we have constructed a 256 port experimental setup that can be shown here. So here's the experiment that we did that shows actually the data generation stage, the broadcast and select stage here for two contending inputs where we can see the wavelength converters built out of SOA MZIs, the fiber delay line buffering stage, and the outgoing port where the contending partners, packets are then wavelength converted and launched into the AWGR that you can see here. And by scaling this to 32 inputs and using 32 times 32 AWGR switches, you get actually a 1024 port experimental setup. Here you can see two incoming packet traces with packets A, B, C, D, F actually being launched into these two input ports. And here you can see the relevant envelopes used as inputs to the tunable wavelength converters. And at the output, what we can achieve is, first of all, we have the packets, although they are here contending for the same output at the same time slot, here they are all in series, and they live at one time through output 8 when being imprinted on lambda 8, the other time through output 9 when being printed on lambda 9. So this is a photo of the prototype that we have experimentally demonstrated. The upper floor contains the wavelength converters. Here's the FPGA controller, the AWGR, and the shared delay line bank. Yeah, the results are here shown again for the two traces at the inputs, the two respective outputs with the packets being now in series, avoiding the contention between them. And here you can see that they are imprinted on different wavelengths in order to leave the AWGR through different outgoing ports. And here are the bit error rate measurement results. So for every individual packet living through a single output port, where you can see that all of them are error-free routed with a power penalty that is about 2 dB. And we've done this procedure for all possible output port combinations, so for all 32 output ports of the AWGR, and here and for every individual packet, and for every individual buffer stage, so whether it was single packet slot, dual packet slot, up to 4 packet slots. So you can see that the bit error rate ranges between 2 and 3.5 dB, and still error-free routing of all the packets has been recorded. We have used the same architecture with some slight modifications to demonstrate also some multicasting functionality. So by changing the outgoing tunable wavelength converter in order to allow multiple incoming wavelengths to be launched into the SOA MZI, we can have the same packet being imprinted at multiple output ports. As you can see here, for example, packets A, D, C, and D are each one routed to a single output port, but packet B has to be simultaneously multicasted to port 1 and port 16, and this can be here successfully achieved. So this is a layout that allows for multicasting with true optical packet switching. And we validated this multicasting credentials also by changing the spacing between the wavelengths that we want to use for multicasting these two different output ports. So across the entire 25 nanometer span that we have to employ for our AWGR, eye diagrams are very clear and the error-free routing was observed. And we have also started to work out on a silicon integrated version of the switch. Okay, it's still not very easy to go up to 1,000 ports with silicon integrated technology, but we have managed to demonstrate a 9 times 9 port switch by using micrometer silicon technology from VTT and spiral delay lines for buffering the packets actually, and a shell integrated, a shell grating instead of the AWGR. Now, I am evaluating in terms of throughput and latency. Critical point is the following, that even if you use a small amount of buffers, so up to four packet slots with the green curve here, you can see that you can get up to 90%, 95% throughput of your switch. So without using a large amount of fiber delay lines, just four. And latency remains below 675 nanoseconds here with the green curve for four packet buffering setup. So we can get the sub-microsecond latency, and we don't need a large amount of hybrid ley lines for getting high throughput values. And all this comes actually from the distributed architecture, since actually we have to connect 1,024 ports, but at the end, due to this layered architecture, we have to arbitrate between 32 nodes. Only on the vertical planes is the arbitration. Please.
And that's assuming that your load is uniform across the ports, is that?
In that case here, yes. We have done that also with other synthetic profiles where the where traffic was not uniform. And here it turns out that with synthetic, with other type of profiles, you can always get to that point if you know how to configure so what node to connect to which input port of the switch, so as to avoid the contention at every vertical plane. So if you have a prior knowledge on eventually where the load will be mostly directed, then you can configure your switch beforehand so as to have still high performance. And this is scalable as well, in the sense that we have validated that also for 4,096 port configurations. So we don't have a 64 times 64 AWGR to validate this experimentally, but in terms of the vertical planes and what they can sustain, it seems to be feasible to scale up to 4,000 ports. And it's scalable also to WDM versions. And regarding line rate, because you are using a novel scheme, a differential biased SOAMZ-IX scheme, which is actually the best one in performing wavelength conversion for non-return to zero signals, we have already shown that this can go up to 40 gigabits per second. So we're currently trying to implement the whole switch architecture at 40 gigabits per second line rates, which means that the capacity will then be around 40 terabits per second if we manage to demonstrate that. And regarding energy efficiency, now, assuming gated operation for all the different SOAMZ ties that we have there, at 10 gigabits per second, we're about 450 picojoule per bit, which is not something spectacular. But since the power consumed remains the same, it's transparent to the line rate, if we manage now to demonstrate at 40G, this means that the energy efficiency comes down to 113 picojoule per bit, which is almost three times lower compared to what the electronic switches can show, can have, as I showed you before. So now I'm changing the topic, going deeper into the hierarchy down to the board level. To talk about disaggregation at port level, actually we could name that as trying to beat the QPI protocol and build an optical point-to-point board level interconnect for more than 8 sockets connectivity. So let us have a look in the processing area and how we can have, how we can increase the processing power by synergizing actually several processors together. So here is a graph showing actually all the different processor technologies that came out till a few years ago. So we can isolate here several areas. This is the area of with more than 1,000 cores on a chip, typically the NVIDIA CUDA cores, which are relatively low performance processing cores. This is the area of the many core architectures with more than 64 processing cores allowing up to 3.5 teraflops. But once it comes to high performance multi-core machines, then it's very difficult to have chips with more than 32 cores. So obviously the best performance would come if we can synergize the high performance cores in a high number of core configurations. So the way to increase the number of cores and still using high performance processor cores is actually done with the multi-socket configuration. So the 4-socket and 8-socket, which allows actually 4 or 8 respectively chip multiprocessors to be connected together at board level, so can reach up to 7.2 teraflops, allowing the direct interconnection between them. If we pay a closer look into the inner anatomy at board level, here are the following solutions that someone can have. In order to increase, obviously, the number of sockets that you can connect together, you have to rely on switch-based board interconnects. So here you can get unlimited connectivity, but at the same time, you increase latency, power, cost, and size, so you lose all the benefit of having high-performance cores being connected together. So the mainstream solution is to use the direct point-to-point connectivity between the multi-sockets, which is actually the solution used in the high-end server boxes and allows for very low latency, low power consumption, but it has a limited connectivity. So the maximum number of sockets that can be connected together is 4 in direct point-to-point communication and 8 once we increase to dual hop communication. The dominant protocol here is the QPI, which has a 9.6 gigabit per second line rate, allows for up to 38.4 gigabytes per second bandwidth, has a latency between 6 and 240 nanoseconds, and has an energy efficiency of 16 picojoule per bit. And here are the two typical architectures used. The glueless, where 4 sockets are all of them in single hop interconnect layout between them, and the 8-socket glueless architecture, where, however, there are some certain communication paths that rely on dual hop links. So this has a slightly increased latency, but still is applied to the most powerful machines, processors of Intel. In order to go beyond 8-socket communication, the solutions that are used by the industry rely on the employment of switches. For example, Oracle employs the Bixby switches, Bull employs the Boolean switches, and you can see here how they build, let's say, QPI islands that are connected between several, that are connected together with several Boolean switches. But obviously, price versus performance drastically decreases as the number of processors here increases. The latency increases significantly, and a special thing here that someone has to take into account is that these are cache coherent systems, which means that almost 65% of the QPI bandwidth for interconnection is consumed just for updating the caches of the different processors. So for cache coherency updates. So what we have proposed here, this has been pursued within the ICT Streams project. This is a schematic showing an optical board that we propose here, having the sockets at the edges and using here optical interfaces for allowing optical communication between the different sockets. So the board is considered to be a 1300 nanometer single mode electro-optical PCB, allowing for 50 gigahertz RF line operation. The interface of the sockets that we are building will be a silicon-based O-band transceiver, WDM transceiver, as can be seen here, with up to 16 channels, each one modulated at 50 gigabits per second. And we use in the middle an AWGR switch plugged onto the optical board that can allow single hop communication between all interconnected sockets by just selecting the appropriate wavelength that can leave from every socket interface. So this is actually the way it works, by having a socket here, for example, that can have multiple wavelengths activated. You can, if you want to reach, for example, this socket, you have to activate the red wavelength and it goes straight through within a single hop. And at the same time, if you want to multicast data, which is extremely useful for the cache coherency updates, you can just activate multiple wavelengths and all of them will reach all respective destinations, feeding them with the data about what has happened to their own cache here, actually. So the AWGR switch allows actually for strictly non-blocking communication, all-to-all connectivity, is suitable for broadcasting and multicasting, and can go up to 32 input-output ports, so allows significantly scaled-out systems to be built. So the targets that we had set once we started the ICTRIMS project were the following. QPI allows up to 8 nodes. In streams, we wanted to extend to 16. The number of hops in the communication paths are up to 2 in the QPI link. Here, we wanted to have single hop communication across the entire system, so a gain of factor of 2. And regarding throughput, here we are targeting a 5 times increase in the throughput of the system. And regarding power efficiency, instead of 16 picojoule per bit, we were targeting 3.5 picojoule per bit. So now let's see whether we have managed to accomplish some of them. So this is the system architecture with the different sockets, showing here the transmitter engine, the AWGR in the middle. So we have started by fabricating and validating the silicon-based AWGR. It has been the first device, has been an 8x8 device. And okay, here are some experimental results from its characterization. We managed to have 10 nanometer channel spacing with a 3 dB bandwidth of around 6 nanometer and a channel crosstalk of around 11 dB. Here is a photo of the silicon-based AWGR that was fabricated at IMEC. And now we have brought that, we have assembled that onto the electro-optical PCB. This has been done by FCI in Berlin, and we're currently trying to measure that to see whether this will be the first onboard pluggable optical routing engine. Here is the silicon chip on top of the electro-optic polymer board. So we used then, as a first experiment, we used a silicon-based ring modulator and receiver co-assembled with a TIA amplifier in order to validate the routing capabilities of our AWGR device at 40 gigabits per second line rates. So we have used the experimental setup shown here, and we have modulated the ring with 40 gigabits per second, and we have connected that to every individual input port of the AWGR so as to validate at the output what comes out at the possible combinations, input-output port combinations that we are able here to validate. And what we can see clearly open eye diagrams at all possible combinations. And by measuring the energy that was consumed, we come up that the total energy efficiency was in the order of 5.7 picojoule per bit, including thermal tuning. Going from the single channel to multiple wavelengths means that we have to deploy here the WDM transceiver engine, which has been built, designed by us, and fabricated again by at IMEC for a four-channel silicon photonic transceiver engine at the O-band. Here is a closer, you can have a closer look. These are the four ring modulators, and this is here the multiplexer, which multiplexes the four different wavelengths into a single output. This is what we have managed to test out of this standalone chip. And you can see here four clearly open eye diagrams at 40 gigabits per second at all four wavelength channels. And then we continued by bringing this chip onto a polymer board and assembling with electronic driver and electronic TIAs. Here is the photonic chip. Here are the ring modulators. This is the electronic driver co-assembled on the board. Here is the receiver side and the electronic TIA, again co-assembled on the same board. So this came to our lab, and it was a bit tricky to we are still trying to figure out some things with the receivers here, but at least we managed for all the transmitters to obtain 50 gigabits per second line rate operation. So it's a transceiver engine that can allow 200 gigabits per second line rates at four different wavelengths. And this is something that we recently submitted to the ECO conference. And for the transmitters, the energy efficiency is 0.8 picojoule per bit for the tuning, plus 1.5 for the ring modulator. What we also did with this transmitter is that we modulated the micro ring at 50 gigabits per second using just 1 volt of driving voltage, and then launched that into 52 kilometer of optical fiber. Since we're now in the O-band, we don't have severe issues with dispersion, so we managed to demonstrate a record high bandwidth times distance product of 2,600 gigabit per second times kilometer. This has been nominated for the Best Paper Award at the forthcoming Photonics and Switching and Computing Conference for July in Japan. And now let's do the calculations a bit again to see where we stand. So after having this 4 times 50G transceiver engine and the AWGR routing machines, we can see here, by assuming some numbers for the lasers and the SERDES from the literature, we can see that the total energy efficiency is 5.23 picojoule per bit for allowing 8-node communication. So compared to QPI, we save around 68% of energy by using silicon photonics and optical routing edging, allowing at the same time to connect more than four nodes within a single hop communication. And by combining the streams architecture, so the optical boards of streams, with the Hipoλαος optical packet switch, so here we've done an analysis by assuming that we have several of these boards being connected to the inputs of the Hipoλαος, and we have assumed traffic localization in the sense that 50% of the traffic remains on board, 50% has to reach some nodes on another board. And the interesting thing here is that even the P99 latency remains below 610 nanoseconds, and the throughput is high even if we have a small number of fiber relay lines up to two. So just 25 meters of fiber being used for buffering. So this was recently published as well in JLT. So that was all with the optical interconnect stuff. Now if you're not too tired, I may continue a bit with the neuromorphic architectures. So neuromorphic actually called us the next computing revolution, or in other words, the way to bridge the energy wall. And why is that? With the solutions that we have already seen with conventional computing architectures, we have the Coombs law, which actually 40 years ago said that computations per joule will double every 1.57 years. This continued to be as such until the early 2000s. Sometime in 2011, Kumi did the calculations again, and he found out that the slope has declined. So now the computations per joule double every 2.6 years, which means actually that before we could have 100 times efficiency increase every decade, but now this efficiency increase becomes 16 times. And the projections say that we're going to reach what we call the digital energy efficiency wall, which is around here, around 10 giga computations per joule. So the way to go beyond that is still unknown. And one solution that is currently heavily investigated, also due to the rise of the artificial intelligence, has to do with the neuromorphic computing architectures. As you can see here, all this digital efficiency wall, all these developments of classical computing engines lies in that area of that graph. And this dashed line is actually the digital efficiency wall. The y-axis shows the energy efficiency gigamax per second per watt, and the x-axis shows actually the megamax per second obtained per every area of centimeter squared. And during the last years, there have been some hero efforts to deploy some neuromorphic computing machines. We can see here NeuroGrid, Hikan, and the True North from IBM, which already revealed that by neuromorphic architectures, we can break the digital efficiency wall. So they allowed efficiencies up to 10 to 3, 10 to 4 gigamax per second per watt in the case of IBM's True North. So they relied on analog electronics, so chips, analog electron neurons, and connecting a large amount of these chips together in order to reach a high processing power, that with every of these chips consuming just 60 or 70 milliwatts, if I remember correctly. And this has inspired also some researchers from the optical field, and exploiting the progress that we have in the photonic integration technology, we started to make some maths to see whether optics can be used for neuromorphic computing. And why is that? Because photonics is a natural analog platform. So now we have moved away from the digital electronics way. We're in the analog electronics, so why not using analog optics, which are by nature behave analog media. And by doing this maths, this is a graph coming from the group of Prusnal and Sorger, actually. By using silicon photonics, one can see that you can reach the same efficiency as True North and improve significantly the area efficiency. And projections by using some numbers from literature about from nanophotonic components show that you can go significantly beyond what neuromorphic electronics can allow. One very interesting thing here is the following. For the neuromorphic electronics, the highest frequency that can be used cannot be more than a few tens of kilohertz or a few megahertz, since you have to connect several of them together. If we switch to optics, then you can immediately release neuromorphic architectures that can operate definitely beyond 10 gigahertz, which provides ultra-fast credentials to the processing that artificial intelligence wants to enable. So what is neuromorphic photonics? Neuromorphic comes actually from the inspiration of the biology, of the biological neuron, which has an axon, as you can see here. This source is called dendrite, and the signal propagates along the axon depending on how strong this message wants to be. You define here a weight for this signal. This is how actually the electrical spikes, spikes in the biology are working. And then comes at the output where it connects with signals coming from other neurons and sum ups together and stuff like that. So it's easier for me to understand the mathematical model actually below, which in neural networks, we have a number of inputs, the different axons being denoted like that with different weights here. So we weight every input. At the output of the linear neuron, we sum up together, and then we have an activation function. So depending on the weighted sum, we decide whether we want to produce an output signal or not. In order to do that in the domain of photonics, this means that for the inputs we have to use optical signals. For the weights, we can use filters, simple filters and attenuators for reducing the power level. In order to sum them, we can use simply combiners and multiplexers. And regarding activation, you have to rely here on optical nonlinearities. So the building blocks that someone has to build is the linear neuron, so the part until the summation stage, the activation function, but of course now someone has to train, to employ new training algorithms in order to, since someone has now to deal with new functions, new noise sources that are coming from photonics, so it's not that all the methods and algorithms that have been deployed will apply also in neuromorphic photonics. So the two possible ways to construct linear photonic neurons, the first one is a WDM neuron where we add the power levels of the different wavelengths. So they are weighted by using simple attenuators, for example. So you define the power level at the output, you get the sum of the weighted optical powers. There have been several demonstrations using tunable silicon ring filters, drop filters, for example, and multiple wavelengths, mainly coming from the group of Prusnal and Zorger for demonstrating this architecture, as well as the phase change materials to be used as some non-volatile weighting elements. If we go, it's always beneficial if we can reduce the number of wavelengths and use just a single wavelength for doing the same job. So this has to rely now on coherent setups where you add up the electrical fields. So here are four optical inputs. They get weighted in the same way as before, for example. And at the end, you have the sum of the weighted electrical field. And there has been some nice papers from MIT coming out with them. Complicated architecture with cascaded Mach zenders that was used for some deep learning features. Regarding activation functions, the typical functions used are the tanh, the ReLU, and the sigmoid in the deep learning domain. In the optical domain, what has been demonstrated so far has relied mainly on optoelectronic setups that release primarily the sinusoidal activation function. So not really a typical activation that is already well known to the rich portfolio of deep learning. So the typical DL activations are still not optically activated. Regarding the training, this is a huge area now with huge potential actually. There have been only very few works coming out. How to measure the gradient in order to apply in the learning algorithm, how to train by taking into account the imprecision of the photonic components, and the work from our group that is going to appear in transactions on emerging topics in computational intelligence on how to train by taking into account the new activation functions, the sinusoidal function, and the new optical noise sources, how to train a deep learning architectures. We have come up also with a new setup here, actually relying on the IQ modulator, a well-known device every one of us knows, an IQ modulator typically used in the telecoms. So this is a very powerful device, actually. It's a basic algebraic unit, as you can see here. For example, if you apply signal here, a signal here, and change the phase with this phase modulator, what you can get through maths is actually the linear sum, the linear weighted sum of these two inputs. We have validated this experimentally. For example, this is the signal coming from the upper branch, signal from the lower branch. And if we make the phase difference to be zero, they add, so we get the addition here. If we make the phase difference to be pi, they subtract, so we get the absolute zero. You can notice that here also as well, we shifted this version. So here, if we subtract from this time trace, this pulse trace, this one, you can get the difference, but you lose the information of sign. So you get the optical power here. It's valid, but it's the absolute value. So the sign information, whether it's positive or negative, is in the phase of the optical carrier, cannot be seen on the oscilloscope. In order to allow this information to be seen, we have modified it by operating one of the modulators at its quadrature point. So by launching a biasing signal, actually. By using this biasing signal, you can see here the bias and the pulses. The bias and the pulses at the second branch. This is the addition, and this is the subtraction. In this way, the phase information can get imprinted onto the optical power, since you create holes below the DC bias once you have a negative result. So you get all the phase at both sides of the DC bias, actually, imprinted now as an optical power signal. And what we have done here, okay, I'm not going to explain that in detail, we have extended that, so copied the modulators and the phase modulator, flipped horizontally, flipped again vertically, and we have combined all of them in one device. So it's actually a dual IQ modulator. In this way, we have a modulator here for defining the X input signal, a modulator here for defining the weight, a modulator for defining the sign, positive or negative, for every one of your inputs. So it's actually the basic dual axon neuron cell that someone can use. We have analyzed mathematically and via simulations its performance, and we have also analyzed how to build a complete N-input coherent neuron. We have designed a chip with the University of Southampton and Frederick Curtis. Now it's in the fabrication phase, a silicon chip that we hope we can test this layout at 25 gigabits per second in a few months from now. So it's a 4-input layout that has been designed on silicon. I assume Francesca knows Frederick pretty well. And going to activation function, here we have experimentally implemented a true sigmoid function. So this is a typical sinusoidal function coming from an optical switch. We have combined some optical switches, again using some novel ways of operating them, and we have experimentally obtained an almost perfect sigmoid activation. As you can see here with the blue line is the fitting of this curve. And we have tested that also in a WDM neuron, where you can see that by changing the thresholding level, we can define what will be the output of the neuron, whether we retain 1, 2, 3, or 4 successive pulses. I'm not going to spend time on that. We have implemented that on VPI, and we have trained that to see the performance by using here actually experimentally obtained result for the activation function. Here you can see the pulse traces, and we have done the test accuracy analysis at the MNIST dataset. We can see that even with the physical layer model, we can get very high accuracy, so very close to what would be ideally expected from the training procedure, with only up to 5% deviation. And this is the stuff that is the most recent, actually. We have, it's the first fully trained and experimental recurrent neuron. So we've built a neuron, a recurrent sigmoid neuron with a feedback loop, following actually the layout of recurrent neurons from deep learning architectures. So we have applied We have trained that, so we found out the proper amount of weights that we had to use here. And here you can see the results with a red line of the training process, and with the blue line are the experimental optical pulses obtained. We have configured that to perform a recognition of a bit pattern, so to recognize whenever you have three ones in sequence, so that you can recognize that with this trained optical neuron. And as you can see here, the matching between experiment and the ideal training is almost perfect. So this is a very recent result that we have done at 10 gigabits per second. So to conclude, we have talked about disaggregation at rack level by demonstrating the Hipoλαos switch. We have talked about the disintegration at board level by demonstrating here the streams architecture with the point-to-point optical links. And at the end, we've moved a bit to the next generation computing architectures that are currently researched, talking a bit about our activity on neuromorphic photonics. Thank you very much.
I think we have 1 or 2 minutes for questions, if there are some questions.
Can you give some insight, can you give some insight on how the header processing was done for the optical packet switch? Because the FPGA needs to do the header processing and apply immediately on the wavelength converter, because there's no delay between the split and the wavelength converter.
There was a delay. So we took into account the time required by the FPGA to do the processing, which was around 450 nanoseconds. Okay. So we employed an optical delay at the input of the switch, so as to allow this time to pass.
Okay, thank you, because that wasn't in the figure.
Yeah, probably it was. I don't remember if I kept this there.
So you had like four modulators in 5 millimeters square. What sort of technology do you think that will make that higher density? Because they can't compete with transistors at all at the moment, can they?
No, it can compete with transistor in size, but it can definitely win in line rate. So if you do the maths, for example, then it turns out that in terms of area efficiency, by using the data rates that optics can allow, you can be better than the analog electronics in the field of neuromorphic. And not only that, imagine, for example, the following. It's not only the line rate of a single channel. I didn't have time to put that here as well. By using, for example, this layout, this coherent neuron layout, where you use a single wavelength for doing all the processing, this can allow you at the same time to use multiple wavelengths to go over the same neuromorphic architecture, which immediately, over the same footprint, multiplies the aggregate data rate that you use. So finally, in terms of area efficiency, defined as speed versus area, it turns out that indeed it can be much better than analog electronics. Analog electronics, for example, the IBM, the True North, had a frequency of around 20 kilohertz, something like that. So it's orders of magnitude lower. And this is actually where photonics win.
Okay, let's thank Nikos.